Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our November Benedictine conversation entitled The Promise and Beauty of Restorative Dialogue in Times of Division. I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica. So before we begin our conversation with Ted this evening, I'd like to start us with a little prayer. Saint Benedict always said to begin with prayer to bring the work that you're doing to perfection. And I'm very conscious that November is such a month of gratitude. It's a month of gratitude for me personally. In 2 days, we have Thanksgiving, which is typically a time when we think about the blessings that we have in our lives. And so I'd like to offer this prayer of gratitude. Let us pray. For the expanding grandeur of creation, worlds known and unknown, galaxies beyond galaxies, filling us with awe and challenging our imaginations, we give thanks this day. For our fragile earth home, its times and tides, its sunsets and seasons, we give thanks this day. For the joy of human life, its wonders and surprises, its hopes and achievements, we give thanks this day. For our human community, our common past and future hope, our oneness transcending all separation, our capacity to work for peace and justice in the midst of hostility and oppression, we give thanks this day. For high hopes and noble causes, for faith without fanaticism, for understanding of views not shared, we give thanks this day. For all who have labored and suffered for a fairer world, who have lived so that others might live in dignity and freedom, we give thanks this day. For human liberty and sacred rights, for opportunities to change and grow, to affirm and choose, we give thanks this day. We pray that we may live not by our fears, but by our hopes, not by our words, but by our deeds. We give thanks this day. Amen. Well, I'm feeling very grateful this evening to introduce our special guest tonight, Ted Lewis. Ted is from Duluth, and he is the Restorative Justice Consultant and Trainer for the Center for Restorative Justice and Peacemaking at the University of Minnesota in Duluth. And Ted has quite a background as a practitioner and trainer in the fields of conflict resolution and restorative justice. And we'll be hearing more about that this evening. Ted provides workshops, facilitation services for church communities, and has recently founded a project called the Restorative Church Project. So Ted, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. Welcome. Welcome to this space.
Yeah, thank you, Don. Great to join here.
Yeah. So the other thing that I find very intriguing about Ted is that he's also a poet. So I've asked Ted to begin this evening with a poem. And so he's going to share one of his poems with us. So whenever you're ready, Ted.
All right, thanks, Don. And I'll just be reading it from my screen. But throughout this poem, there is language about walls and bridges, which is going to be a metaphor I'll return to often this evening. Our times are tense with rubbings that divide us into sides. We build up castle walls to guard us, yet they also help us hide. Our fear of verbal skirmishing forestalls the conversations we could have to bridge us to the other side, indeed to those who pose a threat beyond the rampart ridge. Why fear the face of what we most oppose? Why ruminate against complexity? Might truth abide in part with us and them? Might we befriend our Esau enemy? If justice can restore and not condemn, if dialogue can dignify all rifts, our strength to risk can rise to make things right through heartfelt listening, well laden with gifts. Just mercy thus can coexist, despite our past-made walls of insecurity that cheat us from the grace of sacred synthesis, where truth and loyal mercy love to meet, where peace and righteousness rejoin to kiss.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Ted. That was lovely. There's lots to think about in there that leads us into our work for this evening. So as we begin, I wonder if you might start by just telling us a little bit about your work.
Well, there's certainly no shortage of conflict and violence in the world. And we all know, even from our own experiences, that when difficult things happen between us and someone else, or between, you know, our group and another group, there's tensions, there's mistrust, there's rubbings, there's friction. All of that creates a zone where we just don't want to engage the other. It's difficult, it's uncomfortable. And so sometimes when it's not even possible for two groups or two people to work things out, a third party helper is needed, a mediator, a facilitator. So really my work involves the training and being a third party helper to help people have hard but healing conversations. Most of my work has been in the criminal realm. So I work specifically with victim offender dialogue, where after preparation, victims and offenders of the same crime voluntarily choose to come together. And so I have about 25 years of doing that kind of practitioner work. And now I help other programs start. But I've also worked in the field of conflict resolution, mostly in the church world, where people in the church, leaders, sides of a church are having trouble communicating well. And so I'll do the same kind of bridge building work there too.
Bridge building. That's such a great phrase. How did you get involved in this kind of work? If you could just kind of give us a little bit of background there.
Well, in many ways, I feel like my vocation or my calling has called me. I didn't really go to college, and I even did a master's degree, but it was years later in the early 90s, I met some Mennonites on Pine Ridge Reservation that were building a restorative justice model that was customized for the Lakota Nation. And I was really, really intrigued by this. And a couple years later, my wife and I moved to Kansas. We actually lived in a community where there were Mennonites and Catholics together in a rural community. And I became the first staff person of a restorative justice program that was birthed there in central Kansas. And from there, I just kept getting experience. I started doing trainings. We lived in Oregon for a while, where I got a lot of experience doing program management with casework and working with judges and court officials and probation officers and corrections. So I ended up learning sort of indirectly about all those justice systems. And then eventually I teamed up with Mark Umbright at the Center for Restorative Justice at the university. He's been a great mentor to me. Mm-hmm. And altogether, this calling has been a real gift in my life.
So you consider it a calling, like almost like a vocation. So it's an area of passion for you and deep interest that's kind of grabbed you and brought you to where you are. Could you give us a couple of stories or examples of this kind of work that you've done to resolve either crimes or conflicts, you know, any area in which you've worked?
Yeah, I'll just give a real short summary of two that are church related. The first one does have a criminal dimension. This was in a rural area where two young men ended up burning down a Lutheran church. Mm. It was an intentional arson. They were actually looking for precious metals that they could sell off and get more money. But after a string of burglaries, they were apprehended, spent a year in jail. And I learned that the Lutheran pastor of this church had a deep interest in having dialogue with these two young men. And so that pastor, with a team of about eight other congregants, went through a journey of preparation for about 12 months. I met with them to prepare them for joint dialogue. I met with the young men in jail so that they were prepared for the joint dialogue. And when we finally came together, it was about a four-hour meeting. And I could tell lots of anecdotes in that, but that was essentially a time for them to deeply go into what happened. Why did you do this? Mm-hmm. What were the impacts? You know, people said, I was born in this church, and it was devastating to have this loss. And then out of that conversation comes some rehumanizing of both sides, and reparation agreements that are practical get decided after that. So that's a kind of a quick summary of a criminal case. Mm. A non-criminal case that also involved the church involved a pastor and a secretarial staff person. And these two people got to the point where their mistrust for each other grew so thick that they could not be in the church building alone when no one else was around. It was just too traumatic for them to have to navigate their relationship, because they ended up being not on good speaking terms. Mm-hmm. But they were willing to go through a mediation process, and I and another person was able to meet with them. After some prep meetings, we actually had an 8-hour meeting with both of them.
Wow.
And it was a difficult meeting, and they had to say some difficult things, but we had times where we could check in with them separately, and eventually there was some very deep ownership, some deep apology, some deep empathy, and they had kind of what I call a breakthrough, a shift moment, where the weight of the past started to give way to a hopeful future. And believe it or not, the last 2 hours involved them coming up with practical ways of co-working together, of strengthening their relationship, of working things out. And so then we ended up with practical agreements.
Wow. So these are usually situations that the parties are coming willingly, and they've had some prep work. Mm-hmm. And then it sounds like the process itself is quite lengthy. It can take quite a bit of time to move people in this direction. You know, one of the things that is kind of coming to me as you're speaking about this is, in our first Benedictine conversation in September, we had Dr. Patrick McCormick come, and he talked about beauty and justice and the link between the two. And he also, one of the statements he made was that we reflect the beauty, the image, and likeness of God to the extent to the degree that we are community. So it strikes me that as you give these examples, that's what you're doing, is you are restoring community.
Definitely. And ever since the beginning days of restorative work in North America, it was understood that you're not just bringing together harming and harmed people, you're bringing together support people, family members, community right. members that wrap around these conversations, because they have a stake in the conditions in which the harming occurred, and they have a stake in the follow-up peace and safety and reparations and all of that can make things better.
Mm.
So that community dimension is really, really important. And this is largely why restorative justice has such a strong affinity with indigenous models of justice, because in most tribal settings where people have to coexist, they all need each other. And so offense situations, you know, that harm the community have to involve reparative opportunities that restore people to that community mm-hmm. rather than isolate them from that community.
Mm-hmm.
And what's happened in the modern West, because we have such a strong focus on the law broken rather than the harm done, we end up isolating the offender into prison worlds. We end up isolating victims who are captivated and frozen to the past because we don't really serve them to meet their actual needs of emotional healing and reparations. And so I'm so glad that restorative justice has sort of reclaimed that community ownership, bringing back those traditional wisdom insights and practices into the work.
I'm wondering if, you know, in our country, we have such a strong ethic of individualism. So I would imagine that you butt up against a lot of resistance in this work. Am I correct?
Well, it's definitely a paradigm shift. So not only is it a tension between the individual versus the community, it's also a tension between a competitive view of justice and a cooperative view of justice. We tend to think justice is like, justice is done when someone gets punished.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't really understand that leaves the community still a bit broken. It still leaves the offender with a, you know, a badge to wear and a victim without needs that are met. And so restorative justice wants to go a step further and say it's not about being hard on crime or soft on crime. It's about being smart on crime, because now it's lifting up both a high view of accountability and a high view of dignifying supports. And when those two both go up high, there's a way where offenders generally want to make things right, apologize, make amends, mm-hmm. make life changes, because now they're respected. For their humanity.
Mm.
And victims feel respected for their humanity because they have a voice in the process. So it's a very cooperative model. And it is a paradigm shift for our culture, but I think a necessary one if we're going to just have some common sense about creating safer communities.
A question has come in from Greg. He asks if you can expand some on your phrase law broken instead of harm done.
Yeah, glad to. When I teach restorative justice at a college level, I always start the first day and I say, how do you define crime? Give me a definition of crime in 5 or 6 words. Mm-hmm. And so all the students jot one down, and invariably all of their answers fall into 2 buckets. And one bucket is the violation of law, you know, broken laws. And the other bucket is the violation of people, harm against people. And so it's a wonderful way to say, yeah, crime does have both dimensions. There are boundaries that are crossed, there are rules that are broken, and there are people that are affected. We wouldn't have laws in the first place if there weren't impacts to people. What restorative justice has done is it's said the Western tradition has put so much focus on the law broken, which leads to legal processes, competitive methods of justice, and punitive outcomes, that we need to balance that with a focus on the human side, the relationship side, the actual harms that affect people, the harms out of which offenders keep harming, because we all know that hurt people hurt people. And so there's backstories that have to be addressed. Mm. And so what we really want is a balance between a law approach and a harm approach that brings them together and dignifies the people that are most involved as key players, rather than just leaving it to professional decision makers.
Mm. You know, I'm reminded of a friend of mine that I went to graduate school with. He was from Uganda. And he talked about in the smaller villages, you know, when there was some kind of harm done to someone else, the village people would put pressure on the offender and the victim until they would come together in the midst of the community and address it and come through it. Mm-hmm. So I'm aware that culturally there's different ways of managing this. And so you are speaking about in this country our overemphasis or lack of balance in addressing both of those sides of it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very widespread now. Restorative justice resonates with so many other justice forms throughout the world, and even South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the 90s. Mm-hmm. Owes a fair amount to the restorative paradigm, where it allowed for truth-telling, for amends-making, for empathy-building. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't perfect, but it sufficiently allowed an entire society to address deep, violent harms and to shift forward. Mm-hmm. And so that's like at a very macro level. Mm-hmm. And yet at a micro level, it applies to the fourth grader who's chronically stealing pens out of a teacher's desk.
Right.
And there needs to be a conversation there about impacts, mm-hmm, and responsibility. So amazing how the same principles apply all over. Mm. And I think even into the conflict world, where it's not a crime, but just where people have lost trust with each other, where there's division, polarization, clash of experience, clash of ideas, all of this work about dignifying people in a context of sharing and listening and being heard, mm-hmm, applies very well to the kinds of conversations that are very difficult to have in our society these days over polarizing topics.
So how did we arrive here? How did we arrive at, I mean, you know, the last few years have been overwhelming in their polarization, their division. It hits families, and here we're coming into Thanksgiving in 2 days, and there's topics families are afraid to even touch on when they're in a larger group of other family members. How did we get here?
Well, that's a complex question. I'll say a tiny bit, but I'm more interested to talk about how do we respond?
How do we get out of it? Yeah.
How do we hold ourselves in the midst of it? But yeah. a couple short thoughts on how did we get here is that we live in anxious times. We live in times where there is a sense of insecurity, where people are losing trust in voices of authority, where it's easy to blame other sides or other people for the mess we're in. And so all of those anxieties create an atmosphere that's sort of highly charged And when we have our small rubbings at a personal level, they kind of exasperates what we're experiencing on the societal level.
Mm.
And the macro aggression, the micro aggression are always sort of interrelated in my perspective. And then secondly, our culture, our children really don't grow up seeing very many models and movies that have to do with peacemaking dialogue or third-party helpers who aren't using fight or flight as a way to respond to conflict, but are just groundedly present, calm, non-anxious, willing to have conversations without getting emotional.
Mm-hmm.
We're so focused on winning or being right or defending mm-hmm. ourselves, or and so we build these castle walls around us, kind of like I mentioned in the poem, or to use a Star Trek analogy, we easily put up our force fields
mm.
because we basically don't want to be hurt again. And until
we don't want to be hurt again.
Hurt. But actually, I'll play off of that, if that's a bit of a pun. We also deeply want to be heard.
Heard, yes.
And if we're not heard, if we're not understood, if we're not validated for the hard experiences we've gone through, we're usually not in a place to hear something new from the other side.
Mm.
So one of the things I often develop in workshops is that when there are those walls and barriers over a tense topic, a divisive topic, a polarizing topic, the goal is to shift the conversation out of the clash of ideas to real people with real values, with real stories coming together and talking at a more human level. And asking questions of the other that aren't debatable, but just descriptive, narrative.
Mm-hmm.
When did you first come to your perspective? What are the life experiences that have shaped your views? Who are the people you admire that share your perspective? These are story-inviting questions that build bridges, that help people in those emotional conversations kind of get into a better zone where they can actually have a sustained conversation and take interest in each other. Doesn't mean they have to agree with each other on their opinions, but it does mean that there can be respectful, lower emotions around where the other person is coming from.
Mm-hmm. So the wonderful Benedictine value of listening, of course, is so important to what you're talking about. And I could really see how in the prep work before people go into these conversations, you must talk about listening and holding each other's stories. And I imagine.
Well, and facilitators just model listening.
Sure.
So, yeah, that in a formal context where you're preparing people, You model listening well, you validate, you acknowledge, you ask questions that are dignifying and invitational. And all of that is to build up someone's trust so that they carry a credit of trust when they can actually speak with the other party.
Hmm.
And then facilitators get out of the way, because then it's like it's the party's conversation. They don't have to orchestrate it.
So can you just give me an example of, you just said a second ago, to ask dignifying and invitational questions. Can you give us some example of those kinds of questions?
Well, I did a little bit earlier in the context of divisive conversations. In the context of deep harm or crime, those questions tend to be flat out, what did you experience? And
okay.
What were the impacts to you? What was the hardest thing for you emotionally? What's been the most difficult thing for all of this? And then to allow the other party to respond is where the real magic happens.
Hmm.
You mentioned earlier about like how beauty might relate to this whole topic. The beauty is that when people start to share their stories and the other side finds some empathy, some solidarity, some connection with that story, like, I guess they're human too, or I once experienced that. The beauty is that where there was a wall, now there is a bridge. Mm. And that's a reordering of a relationship that was first fraught with tension and division, and now there's a connection. And it's really quite the same in divisive topic zones and conflicts. Is the beauty happens when both sides can see that there's a little bit of truth on each side.
Yeah.
Because what the other person has experienced and the values that are important to them aren't to be argued against. Those are real foundational things that can't be taken away from anyone. And so when both sides validate those deeper human aspects and values, then the beauty is that they are coexisting in a more harmonious way, just like harmony creates better music, as opposed to a dissonant way.
Yeah, and it also seems that in asking these questions, these invitational and dignifying questions that you're talking about, that I think you said to me one time, you talked about putting the center of gravity on the other, which is very humanizing. And
I've developed a phrase called servanthood communication. And it springs out of my love for a passage in Philippians 2. It's a well-known passage where Paul, to the Philippians, is talking about unity and having humility and relational cohesion in the church. And out of that discussion, he launches into this famous theological passage about Jesus not counting equality with God as a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself to be a servant, to take on human form, to ultimately die. This emptying becomes an amazing part of our pattern to empty ourselves of having to control conversations. Because that's really what Paul's talking about to the Philippians is, how do you hold yourself in relationship and communication with each other? He says, don't control things. Don't grasp. Consider the interests of the other more important. And if we can apply that to our listening and speech habits, everything starts to transform. It's like communication becomes a new adventure where now we can serve the other and actually deepen our own spiritual formation. Because this is exactly where Paul is saying, work out your own salvation.
Wow. We have a couple of questions that have come in, if we could look at them. Roxanne says, can you provide a list or give some examples of models and movies that demonstrate peacemaking dialogue? Great question.
Yeah, that is great. And I think they're coming more and more. You know, a year ago, Just Mercy came out, Brian Stevenson's work. And I think just that title is quite amazing. Bringing mercy and justice together is a real restorative concept. And that's about advocating for men who have been falsely accused and end up on death row. And then they are redeemed out of that prison situation. So that's a great one. I think I might have to think a little bit about other ones that involve mediation and facilitation. But there are so many YouTubes, and later I could probably give links, but there are so many YouTubes on peacemaking dialogue now. They're just countless. So it's pretty easy to Google up.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And then we also have another question from Marilyn, who says, have you heard of or worked with human libraries? Are you aware of them?
That I'm not familiar with. but I'm not sure exactly what the tie would be to peacemaking justice processes, except that maybe we have walking books, people who are knowledge banks who can share mm-hmm. orally, perhaps, is what she's talking about.
Mm. Yeah, Marilyn, maybe you could expand on that a little bit. Oh, Marilyn says people share their stories.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the heart of restorative dialogue is storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And then listening, responding, being heard. And I like to think that God's primary mode of revelation is through storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, part of the reason stories are so powerful is because they root everything in things that have really happened. And it's just like a good illustration, a good anecdote, a good simile. It actually creates something more real than a theoretical way of understanding things. So the more we get people talking out of story, the less defensive people are, the more empathetic they become, the more they go into what I call the heart zone and mm-hmm. less in the head zone. Because when we stay in the head zone, we tend to be defensive. We don't want anyone to really challenge our ideas or our thoughts because mm-hmm. we're kind of in the center point. As soon as we go into the heart zone, out of our head zone, then we're thinking about our connectivity to the other person, to the other group. And so good restorative facilitation invites people to lean into that heart zone because they know that's where people can really experience that empathy and shift out of a hurt past to an open future.
Yeah, I'm always amazed with any kind of public speaking or, you know, when you think about preachers, when they're doing sermons and so forth, the minute they move into a story, it's like all eyes are on them. We are definitely people of stories.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Let me just tack on one more piece there.
Yeah, go ahead.
I like to think that all of us can have dual solidarity with offending and victimized people, because if we're really honest about ourselves, we all have wounded histories. And so anyone can be brought into a restorative process because they have something in their background of pain, of being hurt, mm-hmm. and they have something in their background of making choices that have hurt others.
Mm-hmm.
And that dual solidarity really allows us to be open to just about anyone if we're willing to have enough confidence in our human connections with others. And this is precisely what God has with all humanity. A dual solidarity through Jesus, the cross became this amazing combination of Jesus being an offender socially and a lamb that was a victim. And in that combination, I really see that redemption speaks to the healing of both sides, the healing of victims and the healing of offenders. It heals our pain histories. It heals our sin histories. And so this dual solidarity is really part of my whole framework for thinking about how restorative justice aligns with a biblical worldview. Because we know that God dignifies the sinner and God has a preferential heart for those who are suffering.
Right.
And bringing those two together is really what restorative dialogue is all about, bringing the victim together with the offender for deep redemptive conversation. It's a perfect mirror of what's happening theologically throughout history.
In scripture, yeah. Huh. Marilyn wrote in a further comment about the human libraries. She says they are checked out. The human library is an international organization and movement that first started in Copenhagen, Denmark in the year 2000. It aims to address people's prejudices by helping them to talk to those that they would not normally meet. The organization uses a library analogy of lending people rather than books. Oh, how fascinating.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like one of the links is the power of listening to someone who's across the divide.
Yeah.
And creating a bridge with their experience.
Right. Thank you, Marilyn. I'd like to just repeat an invitation. If you've got a question or a comment for Ted, anything he's been talking about that you want further clarification on, please send it in through the chat. One of the things that I've been thinking about and that I keep reading things about in the newspapers is that here we are coming up to Thanksgiving in a couple of days, Ted. And a lot of us haven't been in bigger groups through the pandemic. And there's been a lot of divisiveness throughout the pandemic and so forth. I'm just wondering if you have any like practical wisdom about ways that we can approach this, ways that we can be thinking about this.
Yeah, it's on a lot of people's mind. I've heard it from many angles. People kind of nervous or anxious, and I think a couple things. Just having a type of imaginative, prayerful time before you would be with people. If you're nervous about being with certain family members or friends, take that silent time ahead of time to just imagine yourself holding yourself with your own integrity or dignity in the midst of a potentially awkward conversation. And imagine yourself being centered. Imagine yourself being curious about where the other person is coming from. Imagine yourself using an acknowledgement, like, wow, I can see why that's really important to you. And then just being silent. It's a way. You know, the servanthood communication idea is basically a way to shift out of you gaining from a conversation somehow or gaining the upper edge and wanting the other person to somehow grow or shine or become a better person themselves. And so the more we're really thinking about the best of the other, it'll change the way we listen, it'll change the way we ask questions. So I think that, you know, those are some basic things. And then practically, that narrative-based question that I mentioned earlier is a really nice tool for opening up a difficult conversation. Share with me some of the things that have led you to this position. Why is that really important to you? And just those getting people talking more out of their background is a good angle if a conversation could be had. Frankly, I think at Thanksgiving, people should just say, you know, let's just enjoy being together and enjoy the meal and maybe have another time to talk about this. We'll agree how that can look respectful. So are you okay if we just find a different time to revisit that topic? And that's fine too. You're just setting your own boundary.
Right. And naming some things. That's very important too, because I think a lot of times we just get swept into conversations that we haven't thought about beforehand and how that could happen, which can be painful, very painful on both ends. Let's see. Oh, one of the things, you know, you were speaking a little bit about scripture before. And when you and I met before in preparation for tonight, you talked about the lens through which you read scripture. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about that for us, because I think it's a very important point, and I think it's something that we all need to hear. So,
well, if I recall, I talked about a relational lens.
Yes.
Every time I read the Bible now, I don't just think of it as me alone with God, or, you know, I think of it in terms of the Bible is written in community for community. And when I find the living messages that are meaningful for us today, I reread it with that relational lens.
Mm.
And so some examples of that would be when I'm reading the story of Jesus being met with the religious leaders who brought the woman caught in adultery out of the temple, and they bring her to him.
Mm-hmm.
A relational lens really asks a lot of questions about what's going on in that woman's life relationally.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on in the relational lives of that religious community? How is Jesus mindful of the relational dynamics? And it's a powerful story because he first stoops down to kind of calm the emotional energy,
mm-hmm.
kind of grounds himself, and then he comes back up and he asks, or he gives this famous line about whoever is without sin. It gives everyone something to think about. So he's not blaming or condemning them. He's giving them like something to walk away with so that mm-hmm. they are going to change their relational way of thinking about society. And then he's left with a woman and says, where's everyone who condemned you?
Mm-hmm.
They're not here anymore. And so he's liberating her into a new life. I just find that when you think about offending and victimization themes in the midst of that story, and then you come back to our modern society, it helps place us in groups, you know, that we're all kind of affecting each other, whether it's through systemic issues, prejudices, biases, power issues. And when you read the Bible with that relational perspective, it really helps you kind of unpack those power dynamics and think about how can we do some of that in our own context.
Mm-hmm. I'm also thinking about this woman caught in adultery and how filled with shame she must have been, and how terror-stricken at getting stoned by the other villagers. And when he said that, if any of you are without sin, cast the first stone, he leveled the field. He leveled it. So he made it so that she was no different than the people that were about to stone her, you know?
And that's the point of empathy.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's a powerful one. So a relational lens, a communal sort of lens that we're speaking about the community and relationships, as opposed to just a very rigid, here's what's right and here's what's wrong. Yeah.
Or here's what's for me and my own gain.
Right.
I mean, so much of American Christianity has gotten boiled down to a ticket to heaven.
Yeah.
And if you nod your head and believe and think the right things, then you're sort of in the right camp.
You're in, yeah.
And everyone else is in the wrong camp. But that's such a truncated view of the Bible. I mean, the Bible is so rich with mm-hmm. salvation that's for creation, for community, for families, for churches even. it's just rich. Abundant life is meant to be worked out in the context of people flourishing relationally on this planet.
Mm.
And so when I think about God's mission as reconciliation for all things, like Paul talks about, all things will be reconciled in Christ, that's not just individual souls after we die. That's everything to do with human society, relationship, our relationship to creation, our relationship to institutions, our relationships to coworkers, everything.
Mm-hmm.
Redemption is meant to play out at every level of life.
Right. The Paschal Mystery is happening minute by minute, right? We suffer, die, and rise to new life over and over every day. Yeah.
And I personally feel that restorative dialogue represents the sacredness of that Paschal mystery.
Mm.
When someone has enough courage to apologize, they are essentially willingly dying to their pride. And we kind of swallow, even our Adam's apple kind of moves, you know, when you swallow our pride,
mm-hmm.
kind of hard to get the words out when we apologize. But that's a death that's beautiful because it gives new life.
Right.
And so saying we're sorry is really the equivalent of laying life down for new life to be raised up, because it frees both the offender and the victim
right.
in one fell swoop and opens up a new future. It clears the air. It connects people again. What a beautiful example. And I just feel so privileged over the years to have borne witness to hundreds of apologies, verbal, sometimes written, between people. I feel like life does not get more sacred than that death and resurrection that I experience in those communications.
Wow. We have a question from Greg. Ted, is there a way to make inroads within our counties or for the entire state of Minnesota to introduce, make headway with awareness, and eventually pass legislation toward restorative justice rather than retribution? What are your
Well, Minnesota was one of the early restorative states going back to the 80s. One state to follow now that's probably leading the way with legislative changes at a state policy level is Colorado.
Mm.
So if you really want to track a state that's leading out in the vanguard of legislative change for the better, Colorado would be the one to follow. And I'd be happy if you want to get in touch with me through our UMD Center at Duluth. I can follow up with anyone who might want to contact our center to learn more about how you can get connected to learning groups or practitioner groups locally or statewide.
I'm curious how you would answer this question. I think I probably can intuit how you might, but within the work you do, Ted, I'm sure it's hard sometimes. Sometimes when things aren't moving the way that you would hope, but yet the beauty that you see happen too, it must be personally fulfilling, or I'm sure it affects your spiritual development yourself. So I'm curious, what is your dream? What is your dream?
One of my favorite heroes is a female theologian and speaker named Marva Dawn. She sadly died last April. She introduced a phrase to me that has really stuck with me. She said, for the church to fully be the church in this world, it needs to be reborn in weakness.
Mm.
My dream, if you're wanting me to think big, is that enough people of faith in the biblical tradition in our society can understand the mystery of that phrase, to be reborn in weakness. Because whenever we try to do stuff out of our own strength, or you know, whatever it is, even positive things, it simply gives no extra space for God's Spirit to be manifested through us.
Hmm.
But once we understand the power of vulnerability, the mystery of weakness, even if it looks foolish, that's where God's wisdom and God's strength actually become manifested more than anywhere else. And the Bible is full of this pattern. Hmm. I generally think that American Christians don't fully understand that in the same way the Corinthians didn't quite get it. But My dream, I guess, whatever that would be practically, is that American Christians need to understand what it means to be reborn in weakness, to allow God's amazing redemptive strength to start being more manifest.
That's that paradox, you know, the foolishness of the cross that St. Paul spoke of. Yeah.
I'm still trying to get it.
I know. I had a whole course on it and still wrapping.
But you know, as a way to wrap up, I do think that people who get into restorative justice and understand how it looks kind of soft and foolish, that's because we look at it from the lens of an American strong perspective, or legal perspective, or punitive perspective, or
competitive
winning perspective. It looks foolish and weak, but it's very, very powerful when people apologize and make amends and make reparations. There's nothing stronger in my book.
Wow. Well, the hour has flown by, and so it is time for us to close. I want to thank everyone for being here with us tonight. Ted has typed into the chat box where you can reach him, or you can contact me and I can get you in touch with him too. Our next Benedictine Conversation is December 21st, where we are hosting our guest, Dr. Barbara Sutton from St. John's in Collegeville, Minnesota. The registration link will be up on our website very soon for you to register for that. And I just want to thank you, Ted, for this conversation. It's been really lovely. I'm going to have to really think about so much of what we've talked about, and I'm sure I'll have more questions for you. So I'm wondering, Ted, what words or thoughts you'd like to leave us with this evening.
One of my favorite verses that relates to the topic of this evening is out of Psalm 85. It talks about truth and mercy meeting and righteousness and peace kissing.
Right.
And I guess I'd like to just leave everyone with a thought of what does your communication style look like when truth and mercy and right making and peace are all braided together in kind of a nice unity? What might that look like for you to heal some of the hard things in your past?
Beautiful. Well, once again, thank you, Ted. And for all of you out there, on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to everyone who's out there with us tonight, we wish you and your loved ones a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday with many blessings of beauty, peace, and hope. Thank you very much.